So we created a series called Defeating the Monsters in Your Mind, and it's a workbook that allows you to kind of go through and assess what the monsters are, how you defeat them, and steps. We have internal thoughts that distract us when we play. Example of internal thoughts would be like, how much power I should play, what shot should I choose, how to anticipate a shot, the placement of the ball, the technique for the shot, or my goals. And we've looked a lot on those things with our super coach about how to hit the shot, where to hit the ball. There's also external distractions. My opponent, the score, money. Either I'm playing for money or I'm concerned about how much money my parents have put into my game and how am I meeting their expectations as well. My equipment, did my racket, is it properly strung for the way I'm going to play today or the type of opponent I've got? Did I fix my grip? Are my shoes in good shape? Do I have the clothing on that's going to let me feel comfortable on the court? Because so much of the game is more about feeling when you play. How does it feel to be confident when you play out there? The weather, and of course the crowd, whether it's a home match or an away match. We've also given you 10 suggestions about things you can do to cope with the monsters. For example, the most important probably is just breathing. When you breathe very shallow or nervous, you panic. Your brain says, there's not enough oxygen coming in here, I'm in trouble. Like if you're swimming underwater and you're holding your breath, at some point you realize I need to breathe. And you come up and you breathe very short and shallow and you gasp for air. Well, on the court you do the same thing. You play very competitively and oftentimes you're actually holding your breath. So good coaches will help show you how to breathe when you hit so you maintain the correct oxygen intake and recover really fast when you play. If you watch basketball players before they shoot, they bounce the ball, deep breath, and then they shoot. A tennis player coming up to serve will bounce the ball, deep breath again to get focused and relaxed. Your body has to go to a relaxed level. Say on a scale of 1 to 5. If you're a 5, you're very tight. Most performances are done well at level 2 or 3. So even as a coach, we say, okay, Thomas, what was your attention level? Were you at 5 or 4 or 3 or 2? He said, I was at 2. I said, great, that's really relaxed. You're going to perform very naturally at that level. Positive self-talk. Most of us fight with two coaches at the same time. We have a negative coach that tells us how badly we're playing, who should we be beating, you should be playing better than this, you forgot to do this, and you got to hurry up and get done because you got to go to there. On your other shoulder, you have a positive coach that says, you deserve the right to win. You've worked really hard on this. Play your game. Just make the shots you're supposed to make. All the drills you've done with your coach and your super coach, let it happen now. Most of us, unfortunately, choose to listen to the negative coach. But if you were going to pay a coach, would you pay the negative coach or the positive coach to be your coach? You have to learn to be a positive coach to yourself to be a high-level performance player. Visualize. The mind has an incredible ability to picture what's going to be done, which allows you to physically perform that skill. In basketball, as a high-level player, I learned to visualize the ball going through the net, swish, and then actually do the shot. As a tennis player, I learned to visualize where the ball is going to bounce, even where his return is going to go and how I'm going to respond ahead. So learn to play like almost a game ahead before you even start the game. That picture in your head lets you play automatically without thought. And that's the ultimate goal in high performance playing, is performing without thought. There's 4 stages of learning. One is unconscious incompetent, meaning I didn't know that. Second stage is consciously incompetent, meaning I keep forgetting that, where most of us are. The third stage is consciously competent, meaning if I think about it, I can do it. But this process of thinking about it slows down my actual performance rate. The fourth stage we're trying to get in defeating the monsters in your mind and with your super coach workouts is unconscious competent, meaning that's just how I play. You will digress back into conscious competent occasionally, but your performances on and off the court will be enhanced as you go to unconscious competent, performing at a high level. Remember, it's only a game. It is a fun. You have a special privilege here to play the game. And what I like most about the players on the tour today, like Federer, Nadal, and Djokovic, they can play a 4-hour super competitive match, walk off the court, give each other a good slap on the back, and then turn right into the camera and say, how was the match? He played incredible today. He pushed my game to a new level. I was able to raise it by level at the right time. They can leave the match behind instantly, and they're able to remember, it was just a game. In a 128 draw, 127 guys are going to lose every day when there's a tournament. But you only lose if you had an outcome goal, which was to win the tournament. Your performance goals of getting 70% of your first serves in, competing at a high level, managing your rituals like Nadal does with his bottles on the court and how he prepares himself before he performs, those are performance tasks that help him get into a mental state of performance where he can perform as unconscious, confidently as he can. Pause. When the situation gets tight, take a deep breath, walk away, go back, hang up your towel on the fence, whatever thoughts are bothering you, leave them there. So when you come back up, you're fresh, you're ready to go, and you're in the moment again. Drink lots of water. Our body's made up of mostly water anyhow. When you're thirsty, you're 10% dehydrated, which totally affects your performance level on the court. You drink whether it's hot or not. If it's really hot, you drink a lot. There's different supplements you can take with it, but pretty much water is really good for you to get you going again. Let go of the mistakes again. You cannot change what just happened. It is there forever. What you've got to do is get on to the next stage of performance. Thinking about the mistakes will simply make you perform poorly. For example, the brain does not recognize the word not. When you say, don't hit the ball to the net man, your brain hears, hit the ball to the net man. When you say, don't double fault, your brain hears, double fault. It's because it has to picture what you just said, don't double fault. So it visualizes don't double faulting so that you don't have to do it. The correct way is to go to keep the ball across court, get your first serve in, using positive statements and letting go of the past. Be committed to your performance goals. Your coach and all the drills you've done with your super coach is to get you to perform a skill as best you can. You can't control how your opponent's going to play. He might have an incredible day and you're having an average day. But you might have an incredible day too. Or you could turn it around. What's unique about tennis scoring is at halftime, after the first set's over, it's back to zero again. In basketball and football, at halftime, you're still behind or you're still ahead. In tennis, you can start all over again. So there's a pause, there's a break there that makes the scoring system in tennis quite unique. Be committed. Listen. Notice what's going on. Be aware of what's happening to you as you play. It's very tough to think logically in an emotional situation. The good players can stop the emotions, think logically on what they've worked on in their drills with the super coach and with their personal coach, and go back and perform those goals correctly. So these are some of the 10 ways you can defeat the monsters in your mind. Everybody faces monsters every day. Your schedule, your kids, your adults, whatever you've got to deal with at work, those are all monsters that distract you from what you'd like to do. How you choose to handle these battles will decide if you're a mentally tough competitor and if you're able to defeat the monsters in your mind. We're going to take a more in-depth look at the 5 ways to recognize the monsters and the 5 ways to defeat the monsters in our series as we go along.